did not create me to fear, but you created me to worship daily. So I'ma leave it all right here. Trust in
I'll be seated. your home. The enemy came up against your children. The enemy came up against your name. The enemy came up against your character. You will win, win. You will win, win. The enemy came up against your health. The enemy came up against your finances. The enemy came up against your vision. Enemy came up against your business. You will win. Oh, you will win. Yes, you will.
Praise the Lord, and good morning, one and all. Welcome to the Christian House of Prayers Ministries. It's All About Him broadcast. I'll tell you, what a beautiful day to be alive. What a beautiful day to come into the house of the Lord and to gather around the Word of God. Wherever you are, in your bedroom, your kitchen, living room, wherever you are, grab your Bibles, grab your pens, get ready, because the Word of the Lord is about to come forth in just a little bit. I want to say to the Christian House of Prayer, I want to just tell you how much I so much appreciate you. I believe that you are some of the most dedicated people on this side of heaven, and I'm proud to be numbered with you. I love you with all of my heart, and I think about you every day and every second of the day, and looking so forward to us coming back together that we will be able to look at each other's in the face and thank God for each and every one of you. Amen. I want us to turn in our Bibles, just as an opening scripture this morning, to the book of John, chapter 16, verse 33. And it reads, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulations, but be of good courage. I have overcome the world." Ain't that good news? Don't you love him? Don't you love Jesus? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's good news. He said, in the world we will have tribulation. He said, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Glory, hallelujah. Well, before we get started with our praise and worship, we're going to have our very own elder, Kenneth Holloway, to come and bring us the word, pray for us this morning. And I know he has a word also in his belly. He's a man of God, filled with the Spirit of God and led by the Spirit of God. God bless you, Elder Holloway. God bless you, man of God.
Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come this morning before you, thanking you for allowing us to see another day. We praise you, Father, for your loving kindness and for your new mercies that turn toward us each morning. We thank you, Father, for another opportunity to unite and receive the Word of God. We thank you for our pastor, a pastor after your own heart, Pastor Valerie Holcomb, who feeds us, Father God, continually with knowledge and truth. Father, we just lift up our CCI family today. We thank you for your grace and your mercy being upon them. We thank you, Father God, that if there's any need, that you have already met that need. For we remind ourselves constantly that your word says that you are concerned about the things that concern us. Also, Father, that you contend with those who contend with us. Therefore, Father, we just dispatch ministering angels to watch over, to keep, and to protect. Father, in Jesus' name. Now, Father, as we listen to the Holy Spirit today, we declare that we will be changed. As the word comes forth, it will permeate our heart. I thank you that the seed, Father God, will fall on good ground and that it will produce 100-fold after its kind. Therefore, as the word is being spoken all over the nation, all over the world, all over this state, I thank you, Father God, that ministering angels and that your Holy Spirit is touching people continually. Now, God, allow us to hear what it is that you would have us to do. Thank you that we are called for such a time as this. Father, we don't look as the world looks or say as the world says, for the world says that you live by the sword, you die by the sword. But we say we live by the sword, which is the word of God. Therefore, we rise accordingly. And we thank you this morning, Father, that as your word comes forth, it will bring purpose, renewed state of mind, renewed strength, and I thank you that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Good morning, family of God. Number 622, the priests of the Lord, release a blessing unto the children of Israel, the chosen people of God. And because of that, the blessing of Jesus Christ, we are now those chosen people. So we receive that blessing for ourselves. This morning, we release this blessing unto you. We pray that you receive it by faith. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Please join me at this time as we recite the 91st Psalm. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wing shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Giving is easy, safe, and convenient at the Christian House of Prayer. Give in person in the church lobby on Sundays between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. or Wednesdays between 6 p.m. and 8 p.m. Give online at CHOP.org and choose the tab to give, as well as on the CHOP app. Give by mail at P.O. Box 960, Coppers Cove, Texas, 76522. You may also give using the Covenant Savings Night Depository Box, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, located in the Village Square Shopping Center. Let's continue to be faithful to God, and He will continue to be faithful to us in this season. The CHOP app has everything you need to stay connected to what's going on here at the Christian House of Prayer. Stay up to date on upcoming events. Give your tithes and offerings with ease. Log on to hymnbooks.com along with other sites connected to CHOP and so much more. Stay in the loop and download the CHOP app to your mobile device today, available at the App Store and Google Play. Join us online Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for a hallmark message from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb. Rehearse a word that you've heard. As we stay connected in this season, Log on to chop.org, cciCovenant.com, YouTube, and Facebook every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Hymnbooks in the Foyer has a special discounted sale going on now. Currently, we're selling all mantra binders, spirals, pens, and filler paper at a discounted price. Stop by Hymnbooks counter in the foyer on Wednesdays from 6 to 8 p.m. and Sundays from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. You can also take advantage of this sale by visiting Hymnbooks online at hymnbooks.com. Don't miss your opportunity to take advantage of these 2020 mantra items on sale now from Hymnbooks in the Foyer. A message from Hymnbooks.
Well, praise the Lord and welcome back, all of you that's just tuning in. You've tuned into the Christian House of Prayers Ministries, and it's all about Him broadcast. Amen. Well, we're going to continue along the series that we've been teaching on. We need the axe head anointing, and this will be part 10. The Holy Spirit, because I've had people that have said, some of the people have been saying, well, what is the axe head anointing? So I guess there are people that haven't been tuning in all along. But the axe head anointing is the yoke-destroying, burden-removing power of God. It's the anointing that comes from the Holy Spirit's leading and guiding us in our lives. It's the difference between an axe handle and an axe head. Have you ever heard people say, I'm trying to get a handle on my marriage. Trying to get a handle with my weight. I'm trying to get a handle with my schoolwork. Well, see, that's the handle. That's doing it out of our own efforts, our own strength, our own intellect. But the axe head is the cutting edge. It's where we not only put our effort in it, but we get supernatural anointing, where the Holy Spirit will show us a better way to do whatever it is. Because God has a plan for every area of our life, whether it's marriage, whether it's your job where you work, whether it's raising children. There's a plan and a pattern through the Word of God that God has for every part of our life, every area, every season of our life. And so the axe head anointing is that yoke destroying, as I said, burden removing power of God. It's the difference between being just a woman or just a woman or just a man or just man. In other words, when we have the axe head anointing, then that means that we are totally committed and submitted to the things of God, the principles of God, the Word of God. And meaning that we are aiming to have a victorious life. Now, before Jesus left, he prayed to the Father that the Father would send another comforter, a paracletos, an alos paracletos, another like him. The Holy Spirit is the third person of the Godhead. And so the Holy Spirit is God, just like Jesus is God and the Father God, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And that sounds strange to some people because you don't understand the functions of the Godhead. And so the Holy Spirit function, I believe, has been so set aside over the years. And, you know, people have gotten away from depending on the Holy Spirit. Amen. But now is the time, this time in the season that we're in, we need the Holy Spirit more than we ever have. Because we need him to be able to discern the difference between good and evil. The Bible says that even Satan can transform himself as an angel of light. So we have to have discernment, and we need the Holy Spirit to help us do that. Amen. And so we said on previous messages, just reiterating a little bit, that the Holy Spirit is our counselor. He's our counselor, he's our comforter, he's our teacher, he's our help. The Holy Spirit is the teacher of the church. See, the minister of the gospel, the preacher, whenever you go out to witness to somebody, the Holy Spirit is the teacher. He's the one that will speak to our hearts and speak to our mind and put words in our mouth through the leading of the Holy Spirit, so that we would be able to have an answer for the hope that's within us. Amen. So we need the Holy Spirit for everything, everything. When we got up this morning, we got up this morning, and I don't know about you, but I asked his consulting on everything, even what I put on, even what I wear, even the way I'm going to address you in the morning. Everything, it has to be checked by the Holy Spirit, amen? And so this is what we've been talking about, and we've been dealing with how that we can have a victorious life. Because the bottom line is we want to be in a victorious example. We want to be a praise in the earth. Amen. We want our living not to be in vain. We want God to use us. Amen. In whatever capacity that he desires to use us, we want to be used for his glory. Amen. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57 has been our textual scripture. And it says, But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So we have victory in Jesus. Amen. Victory is not something that we receive as a goal, but victory is something that we receive as a gift because of him in whom we know to be our God. Not that we believe to be our God. We know he's our God. Amen. Those that know God and know the Holy Spirit like God wants us to, and know Jesus, Jesus is Lord. We know that there's victory in Jesus. Amen. There's victory in Jesus, and that's a gift. Jesus is our gift. It's all about him. Every message, every song, every thought in our mind, it's about Jesus. When we say it's all about Jesus, we mean that. It's all about him. And somebody might say, well, what about us? Well, because of what Jesus has done, we have an opportunity to live a victorious life, to live a beneficial life. Amen. And so it's all about him. And so when we learn about a victorious life, we can't have a victorious life without Jesus. We just can't. It's impossible. You can know about God. Some people know God, about God, but they don't want Jesus. Well, you can't have God without Jesus. Some people, they want God, they're okay with Jesus, and they don't want the Holy Ghost. Well, you got to have the Holy Ghost. You got to have it all, amen? But Jesus is in the middle. He's the one that brings it all together because he sacrificed his life for us. Amen. When he died on that old rugged cross, he had all of us in mind. Before we were even born, before we were even conceived in our mother's womb, Jesus had us in mind. Amen. And he said, prepare me a body. God the Father, he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I tell you, when I think about that, I don't have the vocabulary to express my appreciation for what God has done in sending us the gift in Jesus. Amen. And so victory is in Jesus. The Holy Spirit helps us to believe, receive, and walk in what has already been made available to us. And that is a life of victory, victory in Christ. Amen. So last week we left off with the principle of practice. And we've been talking about these principles for the last few weeks, several weeks, because these principles will help us to take up our cross daily so that we can be an instrument of God and that he will be able to use us in a way that I don't believe that we have even tapped in to the full extent yet. I believe that in these last days, because we know time is winding up. It's time is winding up. And we got to catch up. Some of us got to catch up. Some of us got to speed up. Some of us got to slow up. But we have to get in line. Amen. So these principles will help us to remind us. For some it's new. For some it's review. But it's all good. Amen. All of it is going to help us in our road to living a continuous victorious life. Not up one day and down tomorrow, not in and out, up and down, but I'm talking about a life that's a consistent balance, a consistent victory in him. Now, we talked about the principle of purpose, and I can't go back all over all of it, but the first one was the principle of purpose, and this deals with our purpose, because in order for us to live a victorious life, we have to know our purpose. I was thinking this morning about this before I came to church, and I thought about when I grew up. I grew up in Philadelphia. I was born and raised in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And when I was a little girl, I believe about maybe 9 or 10, this particular time, we went to downtown. Well, it was downtown to us, but it was called Ridge Avenue. And on Ridge Avenue, these merchants would have their goods outside. People would be selling shoes and, vegetables and, clothes and different things like that. So some merchants would be inside and some would be outside. It was like a little village down there. And they still sell clothes and things. But at that time, when I was growing up, they were outside, beautiful flowers outside and everything. And it was this one man that sold white potatoes. And this man, he took his purpose of what God had called him to do was so evident in his character, in his demeanor. And he would put those potatoes in that bag. And if it was a bad, rotten potato, he would put it to the side. And one day I remember, I believe it was about 9 or 10 years old, somebody said, "You've been selling these potatoes for years." I'm telling you, that man sold so many potatoes, he looked like a potato. His skin was kind of ruddy like a potato. And he said, "Yeah," he said, "I love selling these potatoes." He said, "Because I put 5 children through college selling these potatoes." He said, "And I meet so many different people along the way." And you know, I thought about this morning. Over all of these years, the people that I've met in my life, that man is one of those people because he made an impression on me. As a young child, he made an impression on me to teach me by his actions that if you stick with something long enough, you'll get the job done. Amen. And so that's purpose. Purpose is when you know your purpose. Now, to some people, selling potatoes wouldn't have been enough. But for him, he knew what he was supposed to do. He knew that's what God had made him and created him to do, was to sell those white potatoes. And I tell you, that made an impact on me. And so when we talk about purpose, I believe that if we really understood purpose, people won't be wishy-washy, in and out, up sometime, down sometime. Do something for a couple of months, then they get tired of doing that and start do something else. We will know our purpose. We'll appreciate the purpose that God, because this is God's will. Sometimes we don't want the will that God has ordained for us. But if we want it, we accept it, we receive it, we walk in it, we build in it, we anchor it down, we let the roots go deep, then one day we'll be like that man that sold those potatoes. Somebody is going to be blessed by our consistency, by our faith in God, and being able to have results. He 5 children went to college off of him selling potatoes. Now, he knew his purpose. Amen. So that was our first principle, that we have the principle of purpose. The second one was the principle of progression. Progression has to do with growth. We have to grow. We have to go from faith to faith, from glory to glory. And we have to learn each step of the way. We learn something. We learn something about God. We learn something about ourselves. We learn what our weaknesses are. We learn what our strengths are. And every step of the way is a faith journey. Amen. And then the third, we talked about the principle of power. The principle of power has to do with the master key that unlocks the kingdom, and that's the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus is the name that unlocks the kingdom, is the key, is the master key that unlocks everything to the kingdom. Amen? Everything, everything. If there's somebody out there right now and you feel depressed, just call on the name of Jesus. Say, "Jesus, I need your help." And I'll tell you, within the self same hour, you're going to see, and your atmosphere is going to change, because the master key of the name of Jesus, if you're born again, if you have the blood of Emmanuel running through your veins, hallelujah. Because when we get saved, amen, we get another nature. We get another DNA, amen, hallelujah. Our mother and our father become our brothers and our sister if they are part of the family of God, amen. But the master key, that's the power. See, there's power in the name. There's power in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so in the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow one day. Every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so it's the master key, Jesus. We can't get in the kingdom without Jesus. Jesus is the master key. And then last week we started on the principle of practice. And the first principle is four principles to the principle of practice. The first practice was to practice careful reverence. And that dealt with a fear of God. Not a cowardly fear, not a superstitious fear, but a fear of wonder and a fear of awe, a fear of knowing that God is supreme. He is above all else. And when we look around at one another, we see the versatility in God. We see how he made the stars and the skies, and you know, he made the dirt. He made our ears and our nose and, you know, our personalities. I mean, the awe of God. He cannot be compared to nothing. And the wonder of his splendor. It makes us get up in the morning and know that I'm about to experience something that is a day that I've never had before. And I know that God has my day. Amen. It's the awe. How are you going to handle this, Lord? It's the wonder of him taking care of everything for us. And even when it seems like nothing is happening, something is happening. Even when it seems like nothing is happening. And then we talked about last week, practice courageous resolve. And this is, as Joshua said, I don't know what you're going to do, but as for me and my house, I'm going to serve the Lord. So we have to have a courageous resolve, because there are going to come times in our life when sometimes we're going to have to stand alone. And we have to make the resolve that even it doesn't matter who it separates us from or identify us with, we're going on with the Lord. Amen. And sometimes even in your own house, in your own family, you might have to stand alone because you have made a courageous desire. Because sometimes to stand and make a declaration or not to go along to get along, sometimes you'll be ridiculed. Sometimes you'll be ostracized. But when you make and you practice a courageous resolve, then you're saying without saying it, I don't care who it separates me from or identify me with, I'm going on with the Lord. Amen. And so today, I want to talk about the practice continual repentance. Can you say that with me? Practice continual repentance. Now, I know that when people hear the repentance, they get nervous in the service because they don't want to hear about repentance. But repentance go along with our lifestyle. Amen. Now, repentance is simply this: to think different, to feel different, to choose to live different. As a direct result of the Holy Ghost conviction imparted to us that Jesus is Lord and King. Now let me say it again. Repentance is to think different, feel different, choose to live different. Now that's it already. That's repent. Think different, feel different, choose to live different. But then this is how you can do this. As a direct result of the Holy Spirit's conviction imparted to us that Jesus is not only Lord, but he's also King. Amen. And so today I want to talk about that today. And I also want to deal with why sometimes good people turn bad. Why does good people sometimes turn bad? Well, over in Luke chapter 18, verse 19, Jesus said unto him, one young man came up and said, "Master, good master, good master." And Jesus said unto him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good save one, and that is God." And if you read on down in the scripture, you know that Jesus began to instruct him to sell all he had and give to the poor. And so what Jesus was saying, he wasn't saying he wasn't God. What he was saying was, there's none good but God. So are you saying that I'm God? Are you saying that I'm the Son of God? And he did not answer. He didn't answer it in other saying, "Yes, I am God." But he began to, he answered the young man and saying, "I am God." He said, "But there's none good but God, save one, and that is God." So why is it sometimes that good people turn bad? It's not good. When I say good, what I'm actually saying, why is it that enlightened people can turn bad sometimes? So go with me to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 4 through 6, and I'm going to show you where I'm getting this from. Why is it that sometimes enlightened people can turn bad? Why is that? Hebrews chapter 6, verse 4 through 6. It says, For it is possible for those who were once enlightened. See, good, I'm saying, good, how can enlightened people, once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift, and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost. Go on. And have tasted the good word of God and the power of the world to come. They shall fall away to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh, and put him to an open shame. Now, the interpretation of that is this. How can it be if a person that has been enlightened, if they don't repent? This is the reason why repentance is so important. If they don't repent, then they will continue in their error, and they will be made ashamed. But God is saying, but if you repent, I won't make you ashamed. I'll put you back to where you belong. Amen. And so repentance is to think different, feel different, and choose to live different. Now, I want to talk in the next couple of weeks, I want to deal with three characters in the Bible that will help us to teach us about this continual repentance. Now go to John chapter 17 and verse 12. Now John chapter 17 verse 1 through 26, and you can write that down. John chapter 17 verse 1 through 26. This entire prayer, Jesus is praying for his disciples and all the believers that were there at that time and all the believers that were to come. And this is Jesus' last prayer for his disciples, but one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, is not covered in this prayer because he was a son of perdition. John 17, 12. While I was with them, Jesus is praying to the Father, and this is just one verse from John 17, verse 1 through 26. And you read that in your spare time. Just read that, John 17, 1, 26. And this is the prayer, the entire prayer that Jesus was praying for his disciples and the believers to come. But I want you to focus in on John 17, 12. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept. And none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Now, Jesus mentions in this prayer, if you read the whole prayer, Jesus mentions in this prayer the word world 19 times in this prayer to identify that we are in a world of trouble. We're in a world of trouble. It's trouble everywhere. But as we read our first scripture for today in John chapter 16, verse 33, it says, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. But the world, we're in a world of trouble. We're in a world of trouble. But he said, but be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world. Now, Jesus' prayer was that he was saying that he did not want to isolate us in the world. In other words, we're not isolated in the world. We're not over here in a little bubble or in a cocoon. And all the Christians, we all just stick together and we don't go outside in the world. We just stick together and, you know, we're just in here together. Well, that's not what he said. No, in that prayer, he didn't isolate us. He said, I'm not saying to take them out the world, but he says, but I want to insulate them. Insulate them so that we will be in the world, but we will not be contaminated by the world. Amen. That we would be the light in the world. That we're in the world, and sometimes people say, well, you ain't no heavenly, no good. Well, see, we want to be some earthly good. We want to be in the world, but we want to make a difference in the world while we're in the world. Amen. But he don't want us contaminated by the world. And so the Holy Spirit helps us to with the plots, the ploys, and the plans and of the devil, the all of the noemas of the devil that he tries to come and trip us up any kind of way he can. But God gives us a cushion, because insulation means to cover, it means to shield, it means to wrap around, and it means to cushion. Doesn't mean we won't get hit. No, it means that when we get hit, even when we get hit, we will not be affected by it. It won't take us down. It won't move us out of our place. It won't cause us to give up the faith. It won't cause us to damn God and believe that there's not God. Amen. We have been insulated from the lie of the devil. Before I go on, I want to know if y'all can pull down that that lady with the armor on. Can y'all get that up for me real quick? I don't know how far I'll be able to finish today, but we'll pick it back up next week. Okay. I got this. Minister Jackie Boy sent this to me a couple of weeks ago, and I was so blessed by it. It says, the devil whispered in my ear, you're not strong enough to withstand the storm. And she said, today I whispered in the devil's ear, I'm a child of God, a woman of faith, a warrior of Christ. I am the storm. I am the storm. So what we have to say is, I am the storm, and the devil, I'm going to blow you out of my way. See, he insulates us. This is the attitude we have to have. A storm? Really? Really, devil? You trying to put me down? You trying to knock me down over this storm? No, I am the storm. And you better get out of my way, because I'm going to knock you down every which way I can, you under my feet. And so we have to have that attitude, because if we don't, we'll get wounded, and we won't, we'll be, and we're going to talk about Judas. But we'll be wounded and we won't be able to fight. And we got to be, we in a dog fight right now. We in a downright dog fight. Amen. But we already won. We already won. I don't care what they bring. Walk wilders. I don't care what the devil bring. We already won. It's written in the script. We already won. And so repentance is a practice. It's a practice. And so we have to understand that brokenness, because repentance, we have to understand in this principle that it's a continual practice. It's not a practice, like I said, about fear. It's not a fear you walking around thinking God going to throw something up on you and you're going to, no. And it's not a repentance where, oh God, did I say the wrong thing? Oh, did I do the wrong thing? No, it's not that kind of, it's not that kind of repentance. It's to think different, to feel different, and to choose to live different. But brokenness is the prerequisite of repentance. Unless a person is willing to be broken, they'll never repent. That's the reason why I believe that if a person want to come to the altar, they can come to the altar every day if they want to. Every time we have an altar call, they can come to the altar. But sometimes the reason why people keep coming to the altar every time is because they have not been broken. And real brokenness, you can repent. But if you're not broken, then you go back and put them pieces back together again. If you're a whoremonger, you'll repent for that day. But then you'll see a foxy young lady walk by. And okay, wait a minute now. Or you see a handsome young man, Or you see some money lying around, See, there have to be brokenness. And when we're broken, the way God wants us to be broken, we can't be put back together again. Why? Because he wants us to be transformed. When we're transformed, that caterpillar turns into a butterfly. And that butterfly can never go back to being a caterpillar. It never can go back. And even though a butterfly only lives for a short period of time, but all of that transformation was for those few weeks or whatever time it is for that butterfly to show its colors and to fly its wings. Amen. And so we don't know how much time we got here. But the time that we have, we're going to fly our wings and we're going to talk about Jesus. Amen. Isaiah 119, and everybody know in the Christian House of Prayer that that's my favorite scripture, because it says, if you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. Amen. So a person can be obedient outwardly because they fear the consequences. But true repentance comes from the heart. It comes from the heart when there is a willingness to repent, because we know that this is right. Willing and obedient, we shall eat the good of the land. Okay, now go to John chapter 13, verse 2. John 13, verse 2. Again, repent is to think different, feel different, choose to live different. Amen. John chapter 13, verse 2 says, and supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Satan put something in Judas' heart. The devil works on us by trying to put something in our hearts. When it comes to the kingdom of God, usually it's the leaders. The devil hates unity, and he loves division. He understands that our prosperity is connected to our leaders. And when I'm talking about spiritual leaders, but it doesn't stop at spiritual leaders. It's talking about spiritual leaders in the church, domestic leaders, husband and wives, employer leaders, our boss, civil leaders. Amen. Sometimes we wind up, we don't always choose our leaders. In church, we choose our leaders. We choose who we want to sit under. Amen. We choose whose voice we want to hear. Of course, the Holy Spirit, I don't believe we just all eeny, meeny, miny, mo. I believe that the Holy Spirit will direct us to who is the voice that we are supposed to hear. But we didn't choose our parents. Amen. We choose our husband. We choose our wife. We didn't choose. We got our children. We didn't choose them. The ones we got, we didn't choose them. They came out. Amen. Amen. And so we're leaders over them. We're leaders over. We are leaders over our souls, you know. But what I'm talking about basically is spiritual leadership, because I want to talk about Jesus and Judas. Amen. And so the devil, he wants to try to put something in our heart, and he puts something in Judas's heart. I want you to go to, before we go into more scriptures about this, go to 2 Chronicles 20:20, because this is for somebody. 2 Chronicles 20:20, the B part. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall ye prosper. So your prosperity connection is connected to your leader, to your pastor, to your spiritual leader, amen? And if we can get people to question the credibility of their spiritual leader, he will cripple our faith. This is what happened to Judas. Judas got his feelings hurt. Judas' feelings got hurt. The Bible repeatedly mentions that Judas carried the bag. He was the treasurer. What caused him to turn bad was this. I want you to turn to John chapter 12, verse 1, and we're going to be reading 1 through 8. This is what caused Judas' heart to turn. This is what caused his feelings to get hurt. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead, talking about Jesus. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him, at the table with Jesus. Then took Mary still sitting at the feet of Jesus, then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare what was put therein. Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burying have she kept this. For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always. Amen. Now go to Matthew's, because this is the same account, but he brings it out a little different. Matthew chapter 26, verse 13. Matthew 26, 13. It says, verily I say unto you, whosoever this gospel shall be preached in the world, in the whole world, there shall also this, that this woman have done, be told for a memorial of her. Amen. Now, I want you to go to Matthew 26. And I want you to go to verse 8. We're going to read Matthew 26, 8, and then I'm going to tell you to go to 15 and then 16. Now, instead of Judas agreeing with his leader and repenting for what he said, he gets his feelings hurt. Now, Matthew 26, it says, but when his disciples saw it, all the disciples saw Mary wipe his feet with her hair, with this ointment. All of them saw it. It says, And when his disciples, all of them, saw it, they had indignation. All of the disciples had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? This waste. Now, they were saying, this is a waste. It's a waste to pour this ointment on Jesus. It's a waste. Verse 14. Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went into the chief priests. Everybody else heard the same thing. Everybody else heard the same thing. But he mad. He mad. He's mad now. He's mad. Verse 15. And said unto them, what will you give me if I deliver Jesus unto you? And they coveted it with him for 30 pieces of silver. He betrayed his leader for 30 pieces of silver. Now I want you to get the picture of what's going on. Mary comes with this expensive ointment, and she breaks it and she pours it on Jesus' feet, and she wipes it with her hair. And they saying, all the disciples, well, she shouldn't have did that. This is expensive ointment. We could have sold this and gave it to the poor. And Jesus said, leave her alone. For from the beginning, she had this prepared for my burial. And all of the disciples had indignation. But see, Judas not only was he a thief, but he was jealous. Not only was he jealous of Jesus, but he was jealous of Mary. Because Jesus said that from now on, what she did for me, it would be part of the gospel. This will be a memorial for her. Judas was a thief, and he was jealous. He was jealous of Jesus. He was jealous of Mary. Now, when it says waste, Sam, what is this word waste? Is the same word perdition. Perdition. Perdition and waste is the same word. So I want you to just picture in your mind. Picture in your mind. All the disciples said this was a waste. But when Jesus said this woman did a good thing, she's acting out my burial preparation. But Judas was jealous, and he couldn't take it. He was so jealous. He ran to the priest and made a bargain with them, because his feelings got hurt. Because Jesus said, let her alone. See, when people don't practice continual repentance, especially when it comes to their spiritual leaders, sometimes their feelings will get hurt, and they don't understand that the gospel is not only for instructions, but it's for reproof. Sometimes we got to be rebuked. Sometimes we got to be corrected. And a person that's truly connected to their leader, they don't mind the rebuke. They don't, because they know the heart of the spiritual leader. See, he didn't know the heart of Jesus. He didn't know who Jesus was. He didn't have the revelation of who Jesus really was. Because all the rest of the disciples, they said, okay, well, praise the Lord. He said, leave her alone. So we're going to leave her alone. He said, leave her alone. And I mean, the tone, you could see the tone of how he said it. He didn't just say, leave her alone. I mean, the Bible said they was in indignation. They all talking, no, you should have sold that. We could have sold that. You know, their heads shaking and arms moving and legs moving. You know, they weren't just, oh, we should have sold that and given it to the poor. No, they were indignation. And he said, leave her alone. You know, he had the same tone that he had when he went into the temple and overturned the temple, overturned the money changers. Leave her alone. Leave her alone. She's prepared this for my burial. And everybody else, oh, well, we repent. Oh, praise God. Well, the other disciples were, amen. Amen. Well, she did a good thing. Oh, man. Oh, man. Oh, forgive us, Lord. That was a good thing, but not Judas. Because he did not have a repentant heart. He was a thief. He was a jealous. He was a traitor. And so the Judas spirit, it represents the son of perdition. And this word waste, it simply means Jesus was saying, when he said, I lose none except the sons of perdition. He was saying, I lose none except the son of waste. He said, this son, I waste my time on this son. That's tragic. For us to ever come to the point where we can't repent, where Jesus is saying, I didn't waste my time on that man. I didn't waste my time on that woman. They got the Judas spirit. They get their feelings hurt all the time. They're a traitor. They come and sit and come by Yama here, my Lord, and praise the Lord, and then go out and talk behind my back. See, Judas went out, he talked behind Jesus' back. That's a Judas spirit. He went out and he told the priest, he said, what you gonna give me for? In other words, since I couldn't get the money for the ointment, I'm gonna go out and get some money for your life. See, it's a hate. A Judas spirit, I believe a Judas spirit is the worst spirit a person could have in the church. And that's the reason why this principle is so important. And it's a continuous repentance. It's very important because when the devil puts something in our hearts about our leaders, And we know it. Sometimes we know it not to be so, but we want it to be so. Some people, they don't believe that anybody can be true. Judas didn't like Jesus. I don't believe Judas was ever saved. I don't believe he was ever saved because when he says to fulfill scripture, I don't believe Judas was ever saved. Now this word waste means. The Greek word is apolio, A-P-O-L-E-I-A, apolia, apolia. It means perdition. It means waste. It means waste. It means waste. John 17:12, go write it down, make sure. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name, those that thou gavest me. I have kept, and none of them is lost. None of them is lost, but the son of perdition, the son of waste, the son that I waste my time on, that the scripture might be fulfilled. So Jesus knew he was going to have a scripture, he was going to have a son that he was going to have to waste his time on. But go to Matthew 27. But Jesus gave Judas a place of repentance. He gave him a place of repentance because when he was at the supper, at the Last Supper, I'm getting ahead of myself. Matthew 27, verse 1 through 5. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself. See, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See, the devil don't like his own kids. See thou to that. In other words, it's too late. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. Now, for years, when I first got saved, I asked the Lord. I said, God, I said, well, it seemed like to me that Judas, he repented. It seemed like to me he repented. I mean, couldn't he have been spared? Couldn't he have been spared? You know, I said, but it says, and Judas, which betrayed himself, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself. It didn't say he repented to God. He repented himself. He was sorry, but he wasn't repentant. He wasn't broken. He didn't feel different. He didn't think different. He didn't choose to live different. Amen. And that's why we have to practice continual repentance. We have to practice it. At the end of the day, when I get home, this is a practice that I do. I said, Father, I'm asking you, anything that I have said, anything that I have done, anything that I have thought that's been contrary towards your will, your purpose, and your plan for my life, and if I said anything to hurt or harm anybody else, Lord, please forgive me and bring it to my attention, Lord, that I'll be able to openly repent. And sometimes he don't say nothing. Sometimes he points me right to a certain area right away, and I repent from it. Now in John chapter 13, verse 26 and 27, this is the supper, the Last Supper. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. 26, Jesus answered, because the disciples were saying, he said, all of you are not clean. All of you are not clean. And they were saying, is it me, Lord? Is it I? Is it I? Who is it? And Jesus said, he it is in whom I shall give a sup. When he has dipped the sup, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Now, Judas could have repented right there. When Jesus went over to him and gave him that sup, Judas could have said, it's me, Lord. I'm so sorry. I got offended because you rebuked us. I got offended. Oh, please. But no. No. Jesus said, and after the sup, 27, and after the sup, Satan entered into Jesus, to him. Then said Jesus unto him, that thou dostest, do quickly. He said, do it quickly. Do it quickly. Jesus had given him a place of repentance by washing his feet. He washed his feet. And then he confronted him at the communion by saying that the one in whom I shall give sup will betray me. This was Judas' opportunity. And I'm saying to some people right now, this is your opportunity. I don't believe that God would give a message. Because whenever Jesus came to the temple, he always came with specificity. He came for change. He came for something to be rearranged, changed, repent, something to be gained, something to pick up. Amen. And so if you have art in your heart about anybody, your spiritual leader, your husband, your wife, your children, your boss, anybody, the Lord is saying, this repent. This is the time right now for you to call out to God and ask him to forgive you, to forgive you from any wrong feelings, any hurt. Get over the fence. Go around the corner. Allow your heart to be comforted by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Because Judas had the opportunity, but he didn't take it. And that's why Jesus said, whatever you're going to do, go ahead and do it quickly. Good people can turn bad because they don't practice continual repentance. Not one of us want a Judas spirit. Not one of us. Judas was a thief. He was jealous. He was a traitor. His feelings got hurt all the time. He could never get over an offense. Never. Jesus said that he was a son of perdition, a son of waste, a son of waste. And I don't know about you, but I don't want when I stand before the Lord on that great and notable day, that the Lord said, oh, you got in by the skin of your teeth. You got in by the skin of your teeth. I almost thought I lost you. You know, one of the things that the Lord has showed me, and I don't, you know, I can't prove it out in scripture, but I believe that before a person take their last breath, that God give them an opportunity to receive Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. I don't believe that even a person that lived like the devil all their life, I believe that at the last seconds of their life, I believe God showed them a panorama of their life, and he shows them different places and different intervals of their life where he was there. He was trying to get them to receive him and the opportunities that had been missed. But I believe that in the last couple seconds, the last couple minutes, that God gives them an opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. So I'm going to pick this message up back next week, but I want to appeal to somebody. Might be one, might be two, might be hundreds, I don't know. But today, if your heart is hard, if your heart has become hard and callous and stony, I'm asking the Lord to break up that fallow ground, because it's time. It's time to seek the Lord. And if you're saved, if you are already saved, and you have allowed the devil to come into your heart, I say right now, fall on your knees right now and begin to ask God to forgive you and repent. Repent and ask God to help you to get over the fence. Because after you get over that fence, after you repent and you forgive whoever has wronged you, whoever, sometimes people don't even know they hurt you. And you still will carry around. Don't even worry about it. If they know they hurt you, if they know, if they don't know, the Bible says even if somebody hurt you or wronged you, take another brother with you. Go to that person. Sometimes we don't even want to go to them. We just ask God, forgive them, Father. Forgive them and help me. Help me. Help me to forgive, because we have to repent. It's a continuous practice. Repentance must be practiced. Amen. And so do that. I want you to, if you're saved, don't let this day go by without getting that hurt, getting that offense out of you. And if you're there this morning and you don't know Jesus and the pardon of your sins, why do you think we have this? Why do you think hundreds, thousands of ministers are all over the airways? And the only purpose that we're here is to make a pickup. Make a pickup. Because somebody needs to know Jesus in the pardon of their sins. So today, if you don't know Jesus, if you cannot say today unequivocally, if you were to die, and go to be, die, go outside, have a car accident, whatever. Somebody shoot you. Somebody, you know, this, we living in this world today, we don't know. We could be here today and gone today. And we want to make sure that we have our place in heaven. Because this earth is not our home. This place, this earth is not going to remain forever. We're going to, one day we're going to walk and we're going to reign with Jesus, and we're going to come back on this earth and we're going to rule and reign, and you don't want to be left out. And so if you want to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior right now, I want you to lift up your hands right now. And I want you to repeat after me, Father, Father, I thank you. I thank you, Father, for sending your son, Jesus Christ, to die for my sins. Come on, to die for my sins. Today, I receive your son, Jesus Christ, as my personal Lord and Savior. Father, forgive me of my sins. Help me, Father, to walk this life as a Christian. Help me, Father, to receive the Holy Spirit that will teach me, lead me, guide me, and direct me. Father, help me to find my pastor, my voice, the one that will teach me the Holy Scriptures, that would help me to grow in you. Today, Father, I thank you. I receive Jesus not only as my Savior, but as my Lord and my soon coming King. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Brother, sister, ma'am, woman, boy, girl, there's a number on the screen. I would like for you to call somebody. Call these people, these counselors up there. Call them. They're waiting. They've been praying for you. We've been waiting for you. We prayed all week. And we want to know. We want to rejoice with you. And I have something. You call them. I have something I want to send to you that will help you on this journey. We are so delighted that you have come back to the Lord. We are so delighted that you've gotten saved today. We say, thank you, Jesus. The Bible says that he rejoices over one sinner that's saved. Amen. And today you made that decision to make Jesus your Lord. I tell you, it's worth the studying, it's worth the everything that any pastor would do, any minister of the gospel would have to do to get the gospel out, just to know that somebody got saved. Amen. Well, I've enjoyed my time with you today. And I tell you, this is the highlight of my week. I love coming to be with you and just allowing the Lord to be in our presence. It's just an extremely wonderful experience to know that people out there love the Lord. Amen. And I want to say to the Christian House of Prayer that we do have a date that we'll be coming back, and you'll get that date on next week. And we're going to be coming back in the month of September. And so I want y'all to start getting excited. And next week when we give you that date, I want you to start praying about it. Amen. Because I believe that God is going to bring us back. We're going to start our phase one. And then we'll move it from there. Amen. But just remember, always remember that Jesus Christ is the center and circumference, the base and the boundary, the balance and the beauty, the sum and the substance of what our lives are all about. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. I'll see you next week. God bless you. God bless you. Amen.